My dear friends, click on the like button, that is the thumbs up button, press the subscribe button and the bell icon, and don't forget to follow me on Instagram.
Well, something did go wrong there. I don't know how the bike all of a sudden went from third gear to second gear, but I think the chain sprocket is kind of gone now because this is an old motorcycle. So this is my KTM Duke 390 and I bought it in 2013. Not the first batch, but the second batch. And the motorcycle has been phenomenal. It has been very reliable. I haven't faced any issues as such with this machine other than the regular servicing and stuff. So once I got the motorcycle, I think I got it in November. Yeah, 28th November 2013 is when I bought this motorcycle. I took delivery of it that day. And the price was 2,05,000, which I paid in cash. Cash, matlab ki, didn't pay via bank. I mean, I didn't take any loan on it. And basically bank transfer or whatever you call it. And 2,05,000 seemed a lot of money that time, but this motorcycle's prices just kept increasing and increasing. And for that price, nothing offers the thrill that this machine does. The performance is still absolutely lunatic. It accelerates with so much thrust, it scares you silly every time, it wants to power wheelie. This engine is just mind-blowing, and the engine has just got better and better with time. That's the best part about the Duke 390. This engine has become smoother, more refined, obviously with service and stuff like that. Here we go. Skipping second gear, I don't know why. Good amount of thrust, you can see it pulls, and now the wind is kind of a problem. And the front end feels kind of loose at around 140 kilometers per hour. Now in the start that wasn't the case, but with time obviously it has aged and tires also wear out and they need a replacement and stuff like that. But this thing which still doesn't change about the Duke 390 is that it is such a hooligan. It's so raw. It's like riding a motorcycle which is completely raw. It's not about, you know, being smooth, it's not about being comfortable or, you know, taking you on longer journeys. Although talking about longer journeys, I did go to Goa on this motorcycle, and that was a fun experience because I was riding at a constant 150 plus all throughout. And the thing is, I was with other people who were on CBR 250Rs and Ninja, and who were riding like much slower because they couldn't keep up with the pace of the Duke 390. However, we all reached at the same time because I had to stop more for fuel. The fuel tank capacity is like very, very small. Like, I don't even understand why they went ahead and, you know, even put a fuel tank on it. They should be like, you know, get your own fuel tank. That's how small the fuel tank is. 11 liters. Warning comes in when, you know, I think 3.5 liters are left. So when you go to fill, it doesn't take more than 7.5 to 8 liters. So that's kind of embarrassing at the pump, and you're like with government, "Arey, chal be, pura dal, full kar, full." He's like, "Sir, 500 hua." I'm like, "What?" He's like, "Ha, 7 liter hi gaya, 7.5 liter gaya." The phenomenal acceleration of this bike, it just keeps going and going. Now the brakes aren't that great, they're good but lack initial bite. So I had changed the levers on this motorcycle. I had put Pazzo levers. They have excellent feel. You felt like you're, you know, using nice clutch lever as well as brakes. But the problem is with time, there was some loose connection which kept on happening again and again, resulting in some sort of brake being applied all the time, and thus, you know, it kind of started wearing the brake off, and performance it was eating into. So I had to throw those levers and get the stock ones, which KTM gladly did it for me. I gave them the old levers and they changed it very nicely, because I had to cut the wire on and change the master cylinder to the one on the Charisma to use the ones from Pazzo. So that didn't go down very well. However, back to the stock levers, and they kind of suck. Even the stock, this thing, hand grips, they were horrendous. I mean, how can you offer such cheap quality hand grips on a 2 lakh motorcycle? But Bajaj can do that because they're sharing parts with the Pulsar, and you know how much this costs? This costs 80 bucks. 80 bucks is the cost of this. Lever costs 150 bucks. So spare parts are extremely cheap, and KTM service, which is around here only somewhere behind that building if you jump or become a crow. And KTM service has been fantastic. I mean, I have never faced an issue with their service. Whenever I go for a service, I take an appointment, I go and stand there. In fact, before the RCs came, I didn't even have to call. I used to go and be like, "Chalo, service kar," and they're like, "Gladly so." I used to be there on the service bay all the time. Not a word they used to say. They used to happily help me with everything. So KTM service has always been very nice. I'm very pleased with their service. And after Kawasaki left, there was one bay for Kawasaki, two for KTMs. It became even better because there were more bays for KTM now. Actually, now there are more bays for KTM. So recently I got a service, oil change, everything. The initial cost of service was around 2000. Then it became 2.5, 3, 3.5. Now, last service I did was around 3,800 rupees. I got quite a lot of work done, basically. Oil change and, you know, air filter cleaning. So this one has a K&N air filter, stock replacement filter, improves the throttle response minutely, but mostly the sound improves of this motorcycle. Still, it does sound like a rickshaw, like that one you see there. Clutch is on the heavier side, but mileage is really poor. So if I ride like how I'm riding now, not more than 18 kilometers per liter. And Doodhwala, probably. Yeah, not more than 18 kilometers per liter when riding like a mad person. However, if I ride like a sane person, the mileage goes up to around 24 in the city. Out on the highway, cruising at around 100, 120 kilometers per hour, mileage stretches to around 30 kilometers per liter, which is great. But honestly, if I have to ride 100 kilometers per hour on the highway, probably I wouldn't look at buying a Duke 390. I would just buy something like a Splendor or a Glamour 125. I'm kidding, I still won't do that. It is noisy, vibrations are well contained, but honestly, this motorcycle is not forgiving in terms of comfort. It is very raw, very harsh. It's for those who really like to ride and don't care much about, you know, getting tired or stuff like that. It's for those. This motorcycle really excels on that front. Okay, distraction aside, let's give it the beans. I've given everything already, not a problemo. So the suspension setup, I actually put on the stiffest because I like stiffness. It keeps it more blunted and the ride quality is just horrendous. Every bump on the road, I can feel it. Right now, you can't feel any bump on the road thanks to the action camera which I'm using, which is stabilizing a lot of stuff. But I can feel every inch of the road, and that's how stiff this motorcycle is. There's so much wind blast. I mean, I lose 2 kg weight every time I take a ride because of the wind, fighting with the wind all over you. So, left the throttle, no brakes, and I just stand up here and see how it's automatically coming down. That's the kind of wind blast. I'm back to 80 kilometers per hour, no need to apply the brakes. Voila! That's the beauty of wind blast. So I was telling you about the suspension setup. Yeah, very stiff, extremely stiff. Ride quality is harsh. And the problem is, if you ride over bad roads now, you break the 4 coil seals, which I have managed to do twice. First time I did it, KTM replaced it under warranty. Next time I had to pay for it around rupees 600 bucks. So parts are very expensive. The day I bought this motorcycle, the first thing I got rid of those hand guards. I don't like them. And I also removed the sari guard and the tire hugger. And the first time I actually rode this motorcycle was a test ride bike from Bajaj KTM dealer ahead only. And on this road, on the wet, and the Metzeler offered stupendous grip. They are really very good tires, but they don't last at all. Like 8-10,000 kilometers, they are gone. So not really tires for long riding. That's why I would recommend probably something more reliable, rather long term, something like Michelin's or MRF's. However, the Metzellers are Metzellers, and if you're riding this bike, you want grip, and handling is so good. I mean, firstly, the motorcycle is very light and it's very good to maneuver in the city. However, this, my particular motorcycle, does heat up to an extent where if I'm riding in the city, it will shut off. There are no two ways about it. When it will shut off, then it's kind of embarrassing. I have to push it to the side. That's a problem. Gearbox is very nice. Surprisingly, I haven't had many false neutrals, so it does well in that sense. And this particular motorcycle of mine isn't equipped with a slip clutch. However, I'm thinking of getting it retrofitted. It's completely worth the money, honestly. Woo! So the stiffness is so much that, you know, I don't go airborne on these expansion joints on the bridges. That's the beauty of it. And the mirrors, they offer a good view of what's behind, but with a riding jacket on, I mean, I can see my arms, and you know, because there's armor below the jacket, I'm always like, oh, look at me, I'm gymming well. Nice biceps, bro. The mirror has got loose couple of times, so you know, it was coming here and they quickly tightened up. And because KTM service center is nearby only, there's no hassle. I just go there and they get it, get everything done right in front of me. They do it very fast as well. In terms of vibrations, it does vibrate a lot. There is a lot of vibrations, obviously not even close to what Royal Enfield can offer you, because those are British vibrations, so they're a little bit more premium and more like in excess. This one vibrates, but more in the top end, around 7000 RPM when it starts, but peak torque also comes around the same RPM. And heating has a very big positive, I would say, because it does heat up a lot in winter. It's a lot of fun because, you know, the heat is like a massage for you and I enjoy that. But whatever you say about this motorcycle, whether you know, it's not comfortable, ride is stiff, the seating position is supremely awkward. I don't know, I think the person who designed the handlebar positioning and the person who designed the foot peg positioning, they weren't the same. So one designed it in isolation, the other one did the same. So you know, you kind of sit in almost straight, little bit leaned in, and the foot pegs are like really rear set. It just doesn't make sense, but you get used to it. What I've still not got used to is dropping two gears and disappearing, because when I do it, it still flies. I mean, the acceleration, I can't say enough about the acceleration. It is so good. It just like flies every time I give it the beans. And that's the fun of riding the Duke 390, the old one. It has a character. It feels raw. It feels mad. It feels very nice. And when it was first unveiled at ICMA 2012, the tech specs were like crazy. Like if you talk about the engine specs itself, other than the fact that it makes 44 horses and 35 newton meters from a 373.2 cc single cylinder four valve engine, you also realize that they have used Nikasil coating, diamond finger followers, forged pistons and whatnot to make this motorcycle DOHC. So even the hardware is absolutely top of the line. And that's the reason why this machine performs the way it does. I haven't seen a drastic drop in performance even in like 4.5 years. So that means that everything seems to be working fine and well. And insurance cost has been around rupees 5,000. I went ahead and insured it for 3 years straight away. Now zero debt is not available. Earlier I had used zero debt, but once a bike crosses 3 years, zero debt is not available. Is that what the KTM person told me? So I think I paid around 8,000-9,000 rupees for 3 years insurance. And just sit there, peace of mind, don't have to worry, because sometimes I'm so busy in riding and driving that I forget that I have to renew insurance. Happened once and I had to take the bike to the dealer, they checked it and then they, you know, renewed the insurance. Not the best thing to do. The console is nice, so many features on it, but honestly that hype is only there in the start. After some time you're like, okay, I don't care a damn about all these features, just tell me what the speed is, just tell me what the time is, and sometimes gear position and tachometer is useless because the bike revs so fast you don't know when it's gone from 0 to gale force 100, it's just like gone. And then you're like seeing that red light blink, just shift light, and then you realize, okay, force, now I need to, you know, upshift. But you get the hang of it because it does 100 kilometers per hour in third gear. Let's stop on the side and give it the beans. So I'll just do a quick walk around as well. Here we are. Not any such modifications, just I got the motor beam name written here with the rim stripes on both the front and rear wheels. It is a little dirty right now because I haven't washed it, but usually it's always clean and kept in a cover because it needs a lot of TLC. No rusting, no problems as such. You can see the vibes are there. This is moving. Pillion, I've taken a few people with me and they stopped talking to me because of the performance. So right now, it's time to give it the beans. Here we go. 56 in first, 80 in second, 105 in third. Come on, fourth will show me 130. Third, we are in fifth. Fifth will do 156, and in sixth you will do 171, 172, depending on how light you are and how much wind you have to contend with. So my overall ownership experience with the Duke 390 has been absolutely fantastic. Honestly, even though it is so light on its feet, it's so agile, it's not a motorcycle for riding in the city because it heats a lot. And there's no low end as such. So power is mainly in the mid-range, low end is kind of flat, so you really have to rev it. And when you rev it, you realize that, you know, rather than overtaking one people, you have overtaken 50 people, and doesn't make sense to ride it in the city. You might as well ride on the highway. On the highway, it's a complete charmer. Only thing is the smaller fuel tank really sucks there. And if I compare this bike with the new Duke 390, I realize the new one is more practical. However, the old one is faster and has a character and is more fun. Which brings me to the conclusion, should you buy a used Duke 390, you get around 1 lakh to 1 lakh 20,000, you can get a good unit. Just make sure that it is not having any issues, so you can get checked at KTM service, see the full service history, and then you can opt for one. Because these bikes are bought mainly to, you know, go flat out, which means that problems can arise. And here we go. So if you're looking to buy a KTM Duke 390, go ahead, don't hesitate. What the? Anything people do. Anyways, so guys, I hope you enjoyed this vlog of mine, a long-term review of my KTM Duke 390. And if I have to pick between this and the new model, I will still pick the old one. And I'm not saying it because I own one. I'm saying it because the new one has lost the charm. The character is gone, the madness is gone. It's still fast, it's still having a lot of features, it's still kind of value for money. Not really now, 2.85 lakhs on road Mumbai. I bought this 80,000 cheaper, but inflation and whatever bullshit you talk about has raised the prices. When I was riding somewhere towards Goa, someone asked me, "Ye kya Honda hai kya?" That was initial days of the Duke 390. And I was like, why is he saying Honda? Then I realized that the Repsol edition also has orange rims, and probably there is where the reference comes from. Secondly, the Mezzella tires I had on this motorcycle, how many punctures did I have? Guess? None. Zero. Before I changed the tires, there were absolutely no punctures on it. That is just fantastic. Obviously, I only fill nitrogen and I avoid taking the bike on bad roads. And even though KTM is an off-road specialist, this is not a motorcycle for off-road. Many people still, you know, take it off-road. It's not for off-roading, obviously. It's for road riding completely. And doing stuff like this. I mean, I've ridden super bikes, but still the fun of riding a Duke 390 is just something else. And that's because it has a lot of power, it's very light and agile, and it's very manageable. So you can still, you know, there's an old saying which says, it's more fun to ride a slow bike fast than a fast bike slow. In fact, I remember on that very bridge, when I was riding the 390, I forgot everything when I gave it throttle and I said, Honda, ride KTM. Well, that's that. Anyways, guys, I hope you enjoyed this vlog of mine. And if you did, you know what you have to do. Give the thumbs up, that's the like button. And also subscribe to the channel. I will see you guys in the next one real soon. Bye-bye.